Kivik, Hemnes, Kallax. Even if you've never been to Sweden, those terms might still ring a bell. Such is the star power of what is perhaps Sweden's most recognizable export aside from meatballs. We're talking, of course, about IKEA, which, come to think of it, also sells meatballs, about a billion of them a year. What started as a mail-order catalog that didn't even sell furniture is now a worldwide conglomerate with 445 stores and nearly 24 billion euro in revenue in 2020. Even the coronavirus couldn't stop it. Despite 75% of its stores closing at one point during lockdowns in spring 2020, online sales helped save IKEA from experiencing a record loss. IKEA is so successful that it now uses a whopping 1% of the total lumber produced in the world every year. But how can a company known for cheap, disposable furniture thrive in a world where the costs of waste, both monetarily and to the planet at large, continue to skyrocket? Let's start by finding out, how did IKEA become the world's largest furniture retailer in the first place? The company began in 1943 as the brainchild of Ingvar Kamprad, who named the company after his own initials, plus Elmtarid, the farm he was born on, and Agunnarid, his hometown village in Småland, Sweden. Hence, IKEA. After opening stores in neighboring Nordic countries throughout the 50s and 60s, the company really took off in the 70s and 80s, opening stores worldwide. It was at this time that IKEA made possibly its most important branding decision of all, dropping its previously international profile for an image that was more identifiably Swedish.
It's hard to imagine a brand with a more distinct national profile than IKEA. It was actually in the 80s IKEA introduced its blue and yellow logotype, which is supposed to give associations to Sweden. But in the beginning, in the 50s and up until 1961, I think, IKEA was spelled in a French manner, like IKEA. And products, nowadays we have products that give associations to Nordic sounding things. For Swedes, we don't really think about it. It's a sort of an everyday nationalism. But for an American, it's of course a little bit more exotic.
It wasn't just the Swedish colors that the company adopted. IKEA also aligned itself with Sweden's reputation as a haven for modernist design and democracy.
IKEA sort of compares itself with Sweden as we care about you, we have social ambitions, we want to improve everyone's home, we want to help you to get a beautiful home. That's why we have cheap prices. So they sort of, they motivate their low prices with social ambitions. But I mean, IKEA and the Swedish welfare system is not the same thing, of course.
Despite starting its life as a Swedish company, IKEA made moves over the ensuing decades to protect its profits from taxation. The company is no longer headquartered in Sweden. It has a complex system of franchising and ownership, headquartered both in Liechtenstein and the Netherlands. Take a look at the flowchart for these many organizations, and your head might just spin. This labyrinthine corporate structure, members of the European Parliament have charged, resulted in IKEA avoiding more than 1 billion euro in taxes. IKEA said at the time that it's committed to paying taxes in accordance with laws and regulations wherever they operate. After Ingvar Kamprad died as the 8th richest person on Earth in 2018, control of the company shifted away from the Kamprad family, though his 3 sons all retain board seats within the organization. But even if its ties to Sweden and opaque corporate structure are a bit confusing, the company's ambitious plans to evolve itself into a model of sustainability are crystal clear. Those plans include nothing less than making itself a fully circular company by 2030, meaning that all of the resources they use will be renewable and recyclable.
One headwind that they really do face when talking about sustainability is to change the perception that people have about IKEA, specifically Americans, in the way that we think about IKEA furniture. I'm only gonna have this for 1 or 2 years, and I'm not really thinking about the full life cycle. They have split up sustainability into 3 different categories. So one of them's climate change, which is a very traditional way of looking at sustainability. What are you putting out into the environment, or how are you putting out less into the environment that would hurt it? One thing that IKEA points to in some of its advertisement is that some of the kitchen cabinet is now being made from reusable water bottles. So then you don't have those plastic water bottles clogging up the world, and it's now being able to be transferred to something that's going to be in someone's kitchen.
For a company that uses such a staggering amount of lumber alone, cutting down on raw materials is a win, both for the bottom line and for the planet at large. It's even bought tens of thousands of acres of responsibly managed forest to help supply all that wood that they need. And as a retailer with around 220,000 employees globally, IKEA also hopes to make an impact on society at large.
IKEA can address inequality pretty much on a huge scale because they're in so many different countries. When you're thinking about how items are getting from warehouse to store and to people's homes, there's a lot of workers that they have working on these issues. So if a company like IKEA is saying, we want to think about how inequality might show up in all of those different places in our supply chain, then they could make a huge difference.
Beyond vowing to make its workforce more diverse and publishing those statistics, IKEA guarantees a lack of child labor from all of its suppliers, and in some markets like the US has raised its base pay for employees to well above minimum wage. So beyond the cost of materials and a workforce that might be more inclined to enjoy working there, why are they doing it?
Retailers, you have to remember that they're going to make decisions based off of where the consumers are going, so what consumers like or care about. And so right now, every retailer is trying to win over Gen Z, which is the youngest consumer with money. So thinking about the teenagers, young adults, people graduating from college, which ideally is a lot of IKEA's customers. And right now, Gen Z is saying that they really care about sustainability and where the products or items they're buying from retailers are coming from. They care about the supply chain. They like transparency and all of those things. There was this idea that retailers didn't really care, that they were just doing it as marketing to win over a certain group of people who really cared. But retailers are actually doubling down for a few reasons, because that core customer, Gen Z, they still care about sustainability, but they're also seeing that other demographics are starting to really rethink their relationship with material items, with the environment, especially as we spend more time at home.
Buzzy marketing trend or not, the company is already making headway. Last year, Inca, who we can find on that confusing ownership chart, and which owns most IKEA stores, produced more renewable energy than it burned by investing in wind and solar farms around the world. In a statement to QuickTake, a representative for the company said in part, "Sustainability is more than a trend for IKEA. It's the core of our business. We have embarked on the People Planet Positive initiative in order to take concrete, tangible steps to protect our planet by 2030 while encouraging others to do the same."
As a customer, I guess everyone has the choice to decide if this feels real, but based off of, you know, the goals that they set out earlier in the decade to where they are, you know, 18 years later, it does seem like they're making some progress on the goals that they said they wanted to.
And if you still aren't convinced that IKEA is committed to change, those famous meatballs now have a vegan option, in order to, as the company says, lower its carbon footprint.